ผมอยากจะให้ฟังไมเคิลเลวิตเจ้าของรางวัลโนเบลเน้นย้ำอีกครั้งว่าโรคนี้ไม่ได้เป็นภัยเท่าที่หวาดระแวงกัน
We don't have to really speculate. Switzerland had a rather mild lockdown. Trains continued. People could travel freely. Sweden has had a much milder lockdown than anybody. The predicted numbers for Sweden were around 60,000. Sweden looks like it's going to stop at 6,000 at the most. So basically, you know, you don't have to worry about Britain and the USA. This virus really does seem to be limiting. It gets to about 500 to 1,000 fatalities per million people, and it stops. And this we've seen in so many places. I don't think that Northern Italy practiced wonderful social distancing. I don't think that social distancing was practiced wonderfully in New York City. What happened was is that this virus is most infectious and most dangerous before you actually know it's there. And that's why if you're an island and you say, no one comes into my island, that will work. That worked for Taiwan. But if you wait until everyone is, till you've had enough cases and everyone's been mixed, and then you lock down, it has no effect because everyone who's going to be infected has already been infected, and the thing will progress. So this is what happened in New York City because of various mistakes, I guess, about whether the subway should keep on running, whether they should be running more crowdedly. And the same thing happened in London. And, you know, in some ways, it might be a good thing. I think that...
You said the policy of herd immunity is the right policy.
Basically, we see indications that Sweden, for all its, hand-wringing about their method, are trying very, very hard to get different areas of Sweden saturated. What usually happens is that in London, I'm sure one is saturated, but I'm sure there are some parts of England and United Kingdom that have not been nearly as hard hit. And, you know, I think what's happening in Sweden is that these places are being identified and they're allowed to continue. Now, when I say that the deaths get up to about 500 per million, that's assuming that we are not able to specifically protect the very old people. Half the deaths are over 85 in all of Europe. So in a very, very large sample of something like 160,000 excess deaths that we've seen in Europe, collected in a very careful way, half of those deaths are people over 85. And I think that no country has succeeded in having a lot of infection and protecting those people. So in some ways, the deaths become a proxy for how much infection you've had. I think if one set as a goal to minimize, you know, you could argue that if a smart government policy would be to try to minimize the deaths to avoid public outcry, but maximize the level of infection. And you could have done that by simply that only people wearing protective gear go in and out, nobody goes from one nursing home to the other, etc. It's a very expensive solution. And I really don't believe that governments, even given this choice, would have done it, except you could argue that the reason they locked down, which is a much more expensive solution, is because of the public outcry. So you could argue that a smart policy would be to protect the elderly, not necessarily because you are concerned about protecting somebody who's 85 and could easily die a natural death in the next 6 months, but because these deaths are counted one at a time and they lead to a great deal of public concern. One protects the death, even at a very high cost, and then lets the infection get on with itself. Corona is extremely kind, I would guess, to people under 65. The normal fraction of deaths for people under 65 is 16%. Coronavirus is at half that level. So basically, if you're under 65, you have about twice the chance of dying naturally as from coronavirus. Now, natural death includes car accidents and suicide and everything else.